Hello and good afternoon to all the delegates of COP21. I'm so happy and so proud to welcome you to Puerto Galera, a member of the club of the most beautiful bays in the world, here behind me. Bienvenue à tous.
La terre se réchauffe, tout le monde le sait. La terre brûle, beaucoup le disent. Depuis plus de 30 ans, nous avons été alertés. 30 ans de perdus qui vont nous coûter cher, très cher. Mais la terre est notre maison et notre source de vie, la seule. Trouvons les ressources et faisons confiance à nos intelligences. Pour les Philippines, pays en première ligne, et pour Puerto Galera, membre du club des plus belles baies du monde, j'ai choisi d'interviewer quelques personnalités pour qu'elles témoignent de notre situation et de nos actions.
Le président Hollande a passé 3 jours aux Philippines début février. Avec lui se trouvait Nicolas Hulot, un garçon que je connais depuis plus de 30 ans d'ailleurs. La France sera début décembre le pays hôte de la COP21. Les Philippines, maintenant c'est dans le domaine public, sont le pays qui sera le plus affecté par le changement climatique. En tant qu'ambassadeur de France aux Philippines, quel message pouvez-vous passer aux Philippines? Comment pouvez-vous aider cet archipel qui vous accueille aujourd'hui?
Écoutez, lorsque le président de la République est venu aux Philippines en février dernier, et depuis cette visite, nous avons lancé un mot d'ordre qui est résumé sur cette affiche, la route de Paris, elle commence ici à Manille. Alors c'était plus qu'un logo. D'abord parce qu'effectivement la France organise la COP21, ensuite parce que les Philippines président le groupe des pays les plus vulnérables au changement climatique, le fameux V20. Et donc au-delà de ça, je dirais qu'aujourd'hui, la mise en œuvre concrète, parce que nous sommes déjà dans cette phase de la COP21, a commencé aux Philippines. Je dirais que les Philippines est probablement un des pays dans le monde où la France a le plus de raisons de développer les solutions concrètes pour aider les Philippines, le peuple de ce pays, à faire face au changement climatique. Alors, je voudrais simplement vous donner un exemple. Le mandat de l'AFD, l'Agence française de développement ici, c'est un mandat qui est concentré sur la croissance verte et solidaire. Et quand on a dit ces deux mots, croissance verte et solidaire, on a résumé au fond ce qu'est aujourd'hui l'action de la France et l'ambassade de France aux Philippines. Je vais donner quelques exemples. Par exemple, dans le domaine économique, nous avons tout un ensemble d'entreprises, très grandes, mais aussi des petites, qui travaillent dans le domaine des énergies et des renouvelables, le solaire, la biomasse ou l'exploitation des courants marins. Nous sommes dans un pays archipélagique avec 7000 îles, plus de 7000 îles. C'est un domaine que nous pouvons développer et aider de manière très concrète nos entreprises à être présentes pour aider les Philippins à avoir une énergie propre et renouvelable. Mais on pourrait prendre d'autres secteurs, le secteur de la santé et dans le tourisme, ou l'agroalimentaire. Aujourd'hui, un des enjeux dans ce pays, comme dans toute la région, c'est l'indépendance alimentaire. On sait par exemple cette année que le phénomène El Niño va avoir des effets très directs et probablement assez dévastateurs sur les récoltes de riz, mais aussi sur les ressources halieutiques. Là aussi, nous avons et nos entreprises ont tout un ensemble de projets et de solutions à apporter aux Philippines. Je dirais que l'ambassade, bien sûr, a la vocation accompagner toutes ces initiatives. Donc, je dirais que dans tous les domaines, je parlais de l'économie, mais je peux aussi parler de la coopération universitaire, scientifique, de la culture. Je dirais que dans les années qui viennent, dans les mois qui viennent, mais encore une fois, ça a déjà commencé, eh bien, nous faisons en sorte de mettre en œuvre l'agenda et des solutions au plus près des besoins et des Philippins, de la population, et aussi dans l'esprit que le changement climatique, comme l'a rappelé récemment la Banque mondiale, a un effet direct et sur la pauvreté. Et donc là aussi, tout ce que nous pouvons faire aux côtés des ONG et celles que vous dirigez dans de nombreux domaines, fait énormément de choses dans ce pays, eh bien, nous devons bien sûr accompagner. Donc plus que jamais, au fond, le mot d'ordre et le message que passe l'ambassade à tous ses partenaires, c'est faisons en sorte que les décisions qui sont prises et qui seront prises lors de la COP21 soient mises en œuvre.
Then there is soil erosion caused by deforestation. Erosion damages infrastructure, property, and businesses, especially fisheries. But the damage soil erosion inflicts on farming is massive. Erosion increases siltation, that increases the severity of floods while damaging corals, fish populations, and mangrove forests.
One way of protecting Puerto Galera Bay is to reforest the surrounding areas. We planted this with about 4 hectares of teak plant. Okay. Aside from teak wood, we have also nara trees, mulawin, mulave, and other reforestation trees.
What is the impact with reforestation once it is well done to the bay?
One way of preventing of siltation and erosion. So because as we know, siltation and erosion is the number one killer of corals. Because corals doesn't want turbid water. They need clear water for photosynthesis. Aside from terrestrial forests, we have to plant also mangrove trees.
To preserve ecological balance and functionality of ecosystems. So as a biologist, it's also one of my big concerns to preserve nature and human. And here, for example, there is a Mangan indigenous people who are the original inhabitants of Mindoro. These indigenous people have preserved and carried on their traditional lifestyle for centuries. If we want to find solutions to cope for climate change problems, it might be good to be a bit inspired by these indigenous people also, as a way to alleviate effects of climate change is also to reconnect people with nature. The most important is management strategy with mutual benefits for everyone, which means co-management development with indigenous people. This can be done by promoting incentives to all stakeholders to preserve biodiversity and natural resources. And this incentive can be done using ecotourism. Definitely on Mindoro, we are developing together with WL Foundation a rich tourist approach of ecotourism. And this is also a good way to generate incomes and job opportunities for the local while preserving natural resources, helping communities.
The local government has initiated different programs. Like for example, in our area, all over the municipality, we ban the use of plastics for any transactions, whether you buy fish or you buy some foods or materials. Use of plastics are not allowed.
Is it being really implemented?
Yes, and okay, we have some enforcers to follow it up, and you know, there is a corresponding penalty. Second, I call this puno ng bayan. So we always plant regularly. We plant trees, we plant fruit-bearing trees to make it more useful to our people. And also, we have a regular monthly coastal cleanup that we do, of course, in partnership with different sectors. So it's just like a community effort that we really do in our coastal barangays, in our coastal areas. And at least by these initiatives, we can, you know, somehow help the world. Because I believe that it should be all everybody's effort. It's not only the effort of one municipio or one municipality, not only of one country, but of the world.
If a small rise in the sea level would really be as predicted for the next few years, then we're also looking at displacement of ecosystems for removal of some. But again, the impact really redounds to the source of livelihood of so many coastal populations. An increase in pollution or increase in the acidity will somehow also affect organisms which thrive on those bays.
Puerto Galera is just one of the 6 sites in the Philippines where we deployed that we call CCMS. That's the Comprehensive and Continuous Monitoring System. It gets 3 types of data: meteorological, water quality, and then the other one, of course, is oceanographic. We have what we call an integrated decision support system. All the data from that monitoring platform goes to this decision system, which actually is the one that helps the local government make the very critical decision whether to close the bay for people, for tourists, or open it.
We will be able to take the right decision to correct if there is any wrongdoing.
And
go forward.
Precisely.
To have Puerto Galera, most beautiful bay, remaining a full member as this world organization.
I can describe the Philippines this way: mountains, volcanoes, hills, forests, caves, karst formations, marshes, rivers, beaches, of course, mangroves, coral reefs, flora and fauna, landscapes, seascapes. In other words, we have everything the world is very anxious to protect. The Philippines wants to remain globally competitive in terms of ecotourism. That's a very, very important point. And in fact, it is enshrined in our National Tourism Development Plan. That strategy includes diversified and competitive ecotourism products, meaning we are committed to actually creating ecotourism products because the Philippines wants to be a primary platform for educating not just Filipinos, but the world. The reason why we will encourage visitation is precisely because we want people to begin to understand, first, what we need to treasure, what is naturally there, and second, how to help us maintain them. What we are trying to illustrate here is this: for ecotourism to succeed, it must also be worth the trouble.
Indeed.
Because we cannot expect the community to join us in ecotourism if the activity, by definition, is not inclusive. Therefore, there is a balance between the visitation and the income it will actually generate, or the participation it will actually encourage. So we are encouraging people to have more activities, both in ecotourism and traditional tourism, so that they learn. With each experience, they get better. The government's role is to control the flow of traffic so that people have time to make income, but time to learn and do things better the second time around. If the flow is too weak, the income is too weak, people lose interest. If the flow is too strong, they make too many mistakes. So the ecotourism plan, the plan that is focused on ecology and tourism, is as much a business plan as anything else, with a focus on the preservation of the environment. We believe that sustainability for this century is in fact the core of the tourism business.
We are now on the last day, on the last few hours of COP21. What have we reached? What have we focused on? Humanity actually depends on what you guys, you the leader of the world, are going to sign and agree upon. We already know that unfortunately you will not meet the 2 degrees Celsius increase that we were all hoping to get. So where are we going to be in some 50 years from now? What are we leaving to our kids and grandchildren? Yes, we are 7 billion people, soon we will be 9 billion people living on one small earth. This small earth, it depends on you, the leaders of the world today, to make it livable or unbearable. You are responsible in the face of 7 billion people. I hope you will cope with your responsibility. Maraming salamat po, and goodbye.